Hello, I'm Alan, and I'm so glad that you're here. Today I want to share with you one of the single most important aspects of God that I've discovered in my life. It has helped me to be safe with Him, helped me to grow in Him, it's helped me to mature in Him. And this is outside of the power of praying in tongues, the importance of salvation. But I want to share with you today what gives you a right to feel righteous. Now, many Christians will quote that they're the righteousness of Christ. But more than just being able to say that and know that, you must know deep into the core of your being why you have the ability or the right to call yourself righteous. Many Christians feel they're righteous. If I were to take a poll in a church service and say, how many believe they're the righteousness of Christ? And many hands would go up. But if I were to go to the parking lot and individually ask people, you might be surprised how many people know to call themselves righteous but don't feel that they're worthy of being righteous. Well, I'll be righteous when I do this, when I do that, when I overcome this, when I change this in my life, then I'll be right with God. And the reason why knowing your righteousness and why you have a right to be righteous is so important is because it is the foundation of what gives you the right to ask God for anything. What gives you the right to ask God for prosperity? What gives you the right to ask God for healing? What gives you the right to ask God for to work with you and to help you? What gives you the right? If you don't know what gives you the right, there's many times the devil will trick you and make you feel ashamed, embarrassed, unqualified to ask God for things. But when you know at the foundation of your being, I am the righteousness of Christ, I am righteous, I have a right. That's how we like to explain in the English, righteousness is what gives me a right, what gives me the right to ask God for a healing. And I can tell you, just looking at our church world today, how many people don't really know. They may be able to quote the verses or say the words, but really don't know they're righteous. Is how many people are talked into giving money to receive something, giving time, giving holiness as an offering to God to get something. It's very, very, very important that we get this, you get this in your heart, down to the depths of your heart, because it builds a fight in you, a boldness in you when you come to believing for things. We're going to start in Galatians here. And in today's version of the message, we'll do a couple of these looking at Hebrews and different parts of the Bible. But today we're going to focus on this aspect of it. We're going to look at the church in Galatia. This is Paul's church that he started. Paul was a Pharisee of the Pharisees of the tribe of Benjamin. He was raised under the law, the Jewish law, and if you don't know the Jewish law, the Mosaic law has 613 different laws that you're to abide by on a regular basis. It teaches you how to have your relationship with God. It tells you how to have your relationship with people, what to wear, how to eat, what to eat, how to worship. Everything about your life is regulated by the law. And if you failed at the law, you would have sacrifice under the law through the sacrifice in a lamb or making sacrifices to be cleansed and to keep going. Well, when Paul taught this group of Gentiles, this was a group of people that never lived one day under religion, under the law, trying to know God. They did not have a relationship with God like the Jews did. The Jews had a special relationship with God where they could experience God. And it was through the law, it was through the old covenant that they had that relationship. But as you know, when God stood up in the Holy of Holies and ripped the veil in two that separated the Holy of Holies from the rest of the world, that was God telling the Jewish people that the old covenant is now obsolete. You won't find me, God's presence, in the Holy of Holies anymore. The entirety of the Old Testament had come to its purpose. It has finished its job. I'm not saying it's not, the Old Testament isn't important or isn't valuable. It is. It's still truth. It's the Word of God. But its purpose was to bring Jesus to the earth. It's the document that shows that Jesus is legally allowed to be the Lamb of God and legally allowed to be the firstborn of many brethren. And legally, I'm allowed to be born of God, to be righteous like Jesus, because of what Jesus has accomplished in the Old Covenant. So Peter here in Galatians, we're going to read in a bit here, but Paul had taught his people how to grow in God, how to mature in God, how to explore and build a relationship with God, and did not include aspects of the law, did not include what to eat, eating regulations, did not include circumcision, did not include many things under the Mosaic law in him teaching his church how to grow in God. He left them out. In fact, Paul was accused and almost martyred because he would tell people, Jewish people, don't get your kids circumcised anymore. It's not, you don't need to do that. And he was not so much against the law as much as he was, he didn't see the value of the law, the Judea law, in the relationship with new believers. And he actually saw it as a hindrance, something that was dangerous if taken wrong. And that's what Galatians is about, how to keep and purge out this legalism that was brought into the Gentile church. And I use the word legalism because that's the best word. You know, when you talk to some people, and you start to talk about holiness and standards, I've heard them accuse me, well, you're just under the law. That's the law, brother. I live by grace and not under law. Well, holiness is not the law. Having high standards is not the law. But legalism is when you try to earn something that Jesus has already purchased for you. That's the legalism. And that's the switch over for the Jewish people that they had to accept. They had to accept Jesus like everyone else to be born again. And in that, they had to let go of their own ability to earn righteousness from God by their works and accept that the only righteousness that qualifies going forward is the righteousness that was a free gift of God in salvation. So, what is righteousness? Righteousness is a substance, I would say, that gives you the right. It's the lifeblood of your salvation. In fact, before we go to Galatians, if you'll forgive me, we'll go to Ephesians. And in Ephesians here, chapter 4, Paul talks about this new man. The new man here is the inner body, the inner man, the inner spiritual body with the new nature. The new nature is righteousness. And I want you to see here in verse 24, chapter 4, Ephesians, and that you put on the new man, which was created according to God in true righteousness and holiness. So in your salvation, when you were birthed of God and came to life in God, you were, your inner man came to life. The new nature also first was quickened and brought to life in true righteousness, and the inner body was also brought to life in true righteousness and holiness. This is the righteousness of God. You used to have a nature of sin from your first birth that oozed darkness and sin and taught you. It was the darkness blood of your old first birth. But when you got born again, God took that old nature of sin and quickened it into a nature of righteousness, which means now your inner man, which was brought to life, is righteous because of the new nature. If you're born again in any capacity, you know, someone's born again and they're not the best example of a Christian. They don't remind you of Christ in some areas of their life. Maybe they're struggling with an area, but they are still righteous, not because of what they're doing, but because the nature in them is what makes them righteous. If you want to know if you're righteous enough to receive something from God, it starts with, are you born again? Are you a child of God? Do you have His nature in you? The nature of Christ is righteousness. It is what makes you righteous. You can't add to it, and you can't take away from it. And that's what Paul would have taught his church in Galatia, that they're the righteousness of Christ because of their salvation, not because of anything they've done. And you can imagine his frustration. When you're a pastor, you really your heart's to take care of people, especially the younger ones, or the broken ones, or the hurting ones, or the less mature ones. Your heart is to protect them and save them from things that might distract them or destroy them. And so you can imagine Paul's heart as a pastor when he found out that a group of Judaizers, they're called. This is a sect of the church at the time that came out of Israel. And these were usually Jewish people who got saved. And they would have said something like, I'll accept that the Gentiles can be children of God, just like us Jews are children of God through Jesus. But they have to do extra things that are in the old covenant for us to accept that. And so they would come into a church. Like, why don't they just leave Paul's church alone? Why are they trying to come in and reteach things? Well, that's what they did. They came in and they began to teach the Gentiles that we'll accept that you get to go to heaven, but if you're really going to be a child of God, you have to include certain things in your life, in your day-to-day life, certain laws under the old covenant that they wanted to carry over into the new covenant, which is really quite shocking when you think about it. When I meet people, I'm often surprised when I talk to people who are legalistic in the way they see themselves as God, and how they are actually accepting and enjoying that message of legalism. And at first it puzzled me, like, why are you so excited about legalism? All these extra rules in your life. I couldn't get it, but then I understood that the outward man, the flesh, loves legalism because it tells the flesh exactly what to do to be safe with God. If you do this and do this and do that, then you're okay with God. Then tomorrow do this, 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 and you're okay with God. And the outward man enjoys legalism as much as enjoys pornography or alcohol, because it's a language of the flesh that allows the flesh to feel safe, at peace with God, because you did your duty. You did just enough today. And like any child, if you give them rules to obey, they'll do just enough rules to get by, and then it's done. I cleaned my room, Dad, just like you said. They didn't do it with their heart. They didn't do it right. They just did enough to make Dad happy or Mom happy. But it wasn't excellent. And that's why our relationship with God must be built on family, because the inner man is born of God. The outward man is not. God's the father of your spirit, not the father of your flesh, the outward man. So your inner man, which was birthed of God, loves family, feels safe with family, feels safe with the idea of a father, a loving father, that you don't earn righteousness, you're birthed in righteousness. So we'll read here in Galatians chapter 2. We'll start here for time's sake. Galatians chapter 2. We'll start in verse 11. Don't forget the picture here. Paul's little Gentile church that he started, poured into, taught them how to walk with God, how to know God better, how to grow in God, how to even overcome sin, had been infiltrated by a group of strong preachers who were teaching them from the Old Testament how they had to add these things to their Christianity. Eat what they ate, circumcision, certain laws, certain feasts that they had to keep, Otherwise, faith in Christ was not enough for you to go to heaven. Now, for us Gentiles who have not been around Judaism or the Jewish religion growing up, it's kind of foreign to us to think about this. But this group of preachers were strong preachers, and they used the Old Testament as a battering ram to break down the teaching of Paul and to include things. And Paul is addressing this in Galatians. We'll start in verse 11. I want you to see how dangerous Paul thought this was. Now, when Peter had come to Antioch, I withstood him to his face, because he was to be blamed. For a certain man came from James, who would eat with the Gentiles. But when they came, he withdrew and separated himself, fearing those who were of the circumcision. So Paul's saying how Peter came to the revelation that the Jewish food diet was no longer required. So he was sitting here with the Gentiles eating pork and shrimp and strawberries and things that are not allowed to the Jewish people. Free, Peter was free from that law, from that legalism. And then when these Judaizers came and began to challenge that revelation of Peter withdrew from the Gentiles. So here he was sitting having a picnic with the Gentiles, talking about Christ, having a good time, fellowshipping, eating pork ribs, and just enjoying the time. And then when these Jewish people showed up, these Judaizers, Peter withdrew from them and said, no, they're right. You shouldn't be eating this stuff. It's wrong for us to eat this. We won't go to heaven if we don't obey the dietary laws that God gave us in the Old Testament. And the rest of the Jews also played the hypocrite with him, so that even Barnabas was carried away by their hypocrisy. But when I saw that they were not straightforward about the truth of the gospel, I said to Peter before them all, if you, being a Jew, live in the manner of the Gentiles and not as the Jews, why do you compel the Gentiles to live as a Jew? Why are you taking these Mosaic laws out of the Old Covenant and bringing them into the New Covenant when they don't have a place? They've already accomplished their job. He who are Jews by nature are not sinners of the Gentiles. Knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ. Even we believe in Christ Jesus, that we might be justified by faith in Christ and not by the works of the law. For by the works of the law, no flesh shall be justified. But if we seek to be justified by Christ, we ourselves also are found sinners. If Christ, therefore, is a minister of sin, certainly not. For if I build again those things which I destroyed, I make myself a transgressor. So he's saying, why would I try to introduce the laws that legally brought Jesus to the earth so he could be my representative, my replacement? He gave me righteousness, not my own works. Why, am I still a sinner even after I accept Christ? Is Christ himself not good enough for my salvation? Was the work that God did not finished at the cross? For if I build again those things which I destroyed, I make myself a transgressor. So Paul's talking about destroying out of his culture, his Christianity, the laws that were taught to him as a child before Jesus came. For I, through the law, died to the law that I may live to God. I have been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. In the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not set aside the grace of God, for if righteousness comes through the law, then Christ died in vain. So I want us just to acknowledge here that the reason for the law was very important. It was sent by God. It was purposefully sent by God because it is what Jesus had to accomplish to become the Lamb of God and the firstborn of many brethren. But once Jesus did that, the law was now obsolete. It had completed its work. It had finished what it was there for. And Paul, he took and destroyed that part of his thinking, of his teaching, of his foundation to become a Christian and to walk with Christ. Verse 1 of chapter 3. O foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you that you should not obey the truth? Before whose eyes Jesus Christ was clearly portrayed among you as crucified. This only I want to learn from you. Did you receive the Spirit by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? So we're going to find a theme here whenever you talk about righteousness. The works of the law, the works that you do, versus faith in what Jesus did. Again, I want to be clear. I'm not talking about holiness. Holiness and having high standards is not legalism. That's not the law. Keeping people to high standards is not legalism or the law. I've had many young people, young men and women, when I challenged them on their holiness, they were living in sin, or they were they're presenting themselves unfairly to other people and challenge them on higher standards, they would say, "Brother, you're just being legalistic. You're under the law. We're not under the law anymore. We're under grace." One of my rules for anyone who's a part of me is, if you go to church, be there on time and don't leave till it's over. You don't need to go anywhere. Sit there and pray and be an addition to the church, not just a receiver. And just that one rule of showing up on time, you should see how many young men and women squirm when you put an expectation of just being on time. It's like, you know, the pastor's on time. You want to be a preacher and you're comfortable being late. Well, what happens if you're scheduled to speak and you're not there because you're running late? You should be on time. Oh, brother, that's just legalism. I'm under grace. It's like, no, it's a high standard. It's not legalism. So high standards and holiness is not legalism. Legalism is when you're trying to do something, to earn something that Jesus had already paid for in full. Are you so foolish, having begun in the Spirit, that you're now being made perfect by the flesh? Well, there's an example right there of how the flesh agrees with legalism. The inner man agrees with fathering, with family. Pastor Dave would always say, if it's not family, it's not God. In other words, if the preacher, what the preacher is describing in your walk with God doesn't sound like a family table, sitting at the family table, it's not God. Because you and I are now part of the family of God. We have the very same righteousness that Jesus had when he was raised from the dead. That now lives in you as a born-again believer. You can't add to it, and you can't take away from it. Now, we know you can give up your new nature. If you play with sin long enough, eventually you'll like that sin more than you want God, depending on the sin. And legalism allows an avenue of relationship with God that says, I earned this. You owe me this. I did this, so now you need to do this for me. And if you just take that one line, I did this, God, now you need to do something for me, you will expose so much legalism that's in our churches and our TV programs out there today representing Christ. There's a lot of legalism hidden, trying to make people, speaking to the flesh of people, saying, you can have a relationship with God. If you need a healing, I want you to take some money and send it in by faith. And they're not saying it, but really what they're saying is you need to add something to your faith to get God to move. Well, God doesn't need to move. He's moved already. You're already healed. Jesus already paid the price in full. You're already righteous because of the nature in you, not because of anything you do or don't do, but because you have the nature of God in you, you are righteous. That means on your worst day, you were going to pray, you slept in, you watched a Netflix show, you ate too much cheesecake, you broke your fast, you exaggerated when you talked to your friends. Do you understand? You're still righteous. You're not very holy, but you're righteous. Because what makes you righteous is you have that nature of righteousness in you. That's why it's called righteousness. That's the nature. That describes what that nature is. A billion years from now, we'll be sitting around the throne room of God. You and I will be worshiping Jesus. We'll be on our knees. We'll be worshiping in all of His glory. We can't help ourselves. It's so incredible. And after a billion years of being around Christ, you won't be more righteous then than you are right now. Because what makes you righteous is you have the new nature in you. That's what gives you and I a right to ask God for anything that Jesus had paid for. There are certain things in our desires that are solely based on faith in the righteousness of Christ. Things like healing. You don't need to add anything to your healing. To believe God for healing is based on what Jesus did completely. Your provision is based completely on the righteousness of Christ. If you never give a penny to the gospel, you have a right to believe God for your provision because you are a child of God. You have a right to believe God. If you never share the gospel, you never teach the gospel, you never witness, you never give a penny, you're the laziest Christian in the world, you still have a right to believe God for your healing, to believe God for your provision, to believe God for your freedom from sin, to believe God for your family to be saved. These are all based for even your emotional freedom from emotional battles. Your right to ask God, to believe God for deliverance and provision in these areas is based solely, completely, 100% on the righteousness that Jesus gave you. Jesus already paid all of that in full. Now, if you're believing God for $1 billion, God, I want to be a billionaire so I can give to the gospel. Well, you have to add to that your faithfulness as a steward. Because if He doesn't trust you with little, He won't trust you with much. If you believe in God for to be anointed in your calling or to walk in your calling, to be used of God, well, that also is a stewardship. And you have to prove your maturity and prove your ability to walk with God and obey God. Those are things that you add extra. But the foundational truths of who you are and what gives you a right to believe God for healing, for provision, for salvation, for salvation of your family, for deliverance from sin, from overcoming strongholds in your emotions, is all based on our belief that Jesus paid the price in full. And because He paid the price in full, I can receive this. I just have to believe. I can't earn it or work for it. And the frustration comes when you're believing for something, you're not seeing the answer yet. The enemy comes and puts you on a treadmill of works, I call it, where he sits on your shoulder and says, well, I know why you haven't received your answer yet. It's because you haven't done enough yet. You need to go win some more souls. You need to go pray for more people. You need to give some more money. And so you get on this treadmill of works and you start running and doing more. And after a week or two, the devil says, well, you obviously haven't done enough. You need to do more. So here you are spending all this time working, doing, trying to earn the right to receive something that Jesus has already paid in full. And you're not moving anywhere. You're on a treadmill. And the devil will sit to you on that treadmill and tell you every week, yeah, you just need to do a little bit more. You know, you gave 15%. Let's give 16%. Let's do more works. Always trying to earn something that Jesus has already paid in full. Knowing that you're righteous is so important. It's the core belief that says I have a right. See, I don't pray in tongues for hours to prove to God that as a, like an offering, God, I'm offering to you my 2 hours of praying in tongues or my 4 meals that I fasted, or I'm not offering to you my hours of worship or my Bible reading. They're not offerings to God. That's fruit. I want to do those things because of what He's already done in me. I want more of God. Many Christians struggle because they're still trying to earn things. I had one lady, a friend of mine, she had a friend who was a pastor's wife, a younger, in her mid-30s. I think she had like 3 or 4 children, and a really wonderful lady, a pastor's wife. And she, my friend said to me, Alan, I don't get it. She got cancer, and it was a horrible experience, and she confessed and believed God with all of her might, and the cancer still won. The cancer ate her up and killed her and left her pastor husband with, you know, the children to raise. And I remember her saying to me, I don't get it. I don't get it, Alan. And she said, I know people who are barely saved. They're still struggling with alcohol. Go in the church and get healed. And this woman who confessed and believed and stood couldn't receive it. Is God so stubborn that He won't, because she didn't say the word right or do something right, that He wouldn't heal her? And I didn't answer then, because that's not the time to answer those questions. But later on we talked, and I said, listen, you know, if you're someone who's barely saved and you're an alcohol, problem with alcohol, and you go to church, you know that the only reason you're going to be healed is because of God's love. But what if you're a good person and you have good things to offer? God, I prayed, I fasted, I gave my money, I live holy. And see, and I give my time to the gospel, I lay my life down for the gospel, and I'm confessing, and I'm doing all these things. See, if you look at those things as how you can earn why you deserve to receive a healing, you're now under legalism. You're under works. The very thing you're doing to try to get healing is what's stopping you from receiving it, because you're looking at it as an offering to God for something Jesus has already done. And that's the danger that Paul saw the church was falling for, because these Judaizers came in and Peter put his stamp of approval on it. We'll start in verse 5, chapter 3, verse 5 of Galatians. Therefore, he who supplies the Spirit to you and works miracles among you, does he do it by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Just as Abraham believed God and it was accounted to him for righteousness, therefore we know that only those who are of faith are sons of Abraham. So being born a Jew does not make you a son of Abraham. Being raised a Jew does not make you a son of Abraham. Being living under the laws of the Mosaic laws in the Jewish tradition does not make you a son of Abraham. What makes you a son of Abraham, to have the right to receive of the faith of Abraham, is that you're born again. That righteousness that you received in your new nature is what makes you a child of God. When you stand before God, and we all know this, we stand before God in the last of the days, and we're standing there, He's not going to have a list of, okay, Alan, here's all the good works you did, here's all the bad works you did. And I see you go, whew, oh, hallelujah, you got one more good work than you did bad work. Good job. Come on in, buddy. You, Joe, I'm sorry, you got one more bad work than good work. Shouldn't have cussed that last time because that put you over the limit. Sorry, you're going to hell. No, the only thing he's going to say, heaven is an exclusive club. It's for family members only. Do you have the nature of Christ in you? If you say yes, he said, welcome into the kingdom of God. Now, how you live your life and what you live your life for will determine your reward. But you're in heaven because you're a child of God. Not because you've earned it, not because you did anything right, because you accepted Christ by faith. And this is what Paul is trying to remove from the foundation of this church that got in there. It's like if you take a foundation, and as a preacher, I have to do this all the time. If I take a foundation of truth and some other preacher gets in there and throws sand into the foundation, it weakens the foundation. And depending on what the sand is, it can really destroy the foundation of salvation. And so my job as a preacher many times is to go and remove the sand out of the doctrine of people's beliefs, because it's devaluing their foundation. It's limiting what God can do in them and through them. So Paul in Galatians is trying to lift the sand out that these Judaizers just spilled into his beautiful little church. Why couldn't they just leave it alone? But they had, that's the power of religion. It's got to get in there and cause trouble. Verse 5 again. Therefore, he who supplies the Spirit to you and works miracles among you, does he do it by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Just as Abraham believed God and was counted to him for righteousness. Therefore, know that those who are of faith are the sons of Abraham. And the Scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, preached the gospel to Abraham beforehand, saying, in you all the nations will be blessed. So he's saying that was the original plan of God through Abraham, was to get the whole world saved, not just the Jewish people. So those who are of faith are blessed with believing Abraham. For as many are of the works of the law are under the curse. For it is written, cursed is everyone who does not continue in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them. I want to read this again. We're going to look at this carefully. Knowing your righteousness at your core is so important. For as many as are of the works of the law are under the curse. So all those preachers who came in under the works of the law, their relationship is established with God under the works of the law, how they do in keeping the legalism, the laws, keeping the laws. Again, this is not holiness. I'm not talking about holiness is not legalism. Having a high standard is not legalism. They're trying to earn their relationship with God with their good works. For as many are of the works of the law are under the curse. For it's written, cursed is everyone who does not continue in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them. This is a very important verse, a very powerful verse, because if your relationship with God is built on your works in any way, in other words, you feel you have a right to be healed because of what you did, then you're putting yourself under a relationship with God through a law, a legalism. That lady who, that pastor's wife, and we don't judge people who go through health issues. I'd be judging myself. We can't judge people who go through things. She might have been just built with a bad DNA battle that she has to go through. And so we're not judging her, but you understand when you're a good person, you can look at your good works as a reason why God should give you things. And the point here that Paul's making in verse 10 is if you want to rely on your good works as the reason why God should give you something that Jesus already paid in full, you're under the curse of giving him enough works. In other words, if you want to earn your healing by how much money you give or how much things you do, go for it, because that is how you are now trapped. But that no one is justified by the law in the sight of God is evident, for the just shall live by faith, is the verse that he quotes. Yet the law is not of faith, but the man who does them shall live by them. Listen to the warning sign where he's trying to save his Gentile church from trying to appease God, please God, through keeping the law, legalistic things, trying to keep the law. We had a group of preachers one time teach a lot about pleading the blood, they called it. And there's a lot of good truths in it, but if you went to the extreme, it could become a not-so-healthy message. And the idea was that you need to plead the blood over your family. The blood was like something I think they would use the example when they put the blood of the lamb over the doorpost and the death angel flew over their home and didn't touch them, that we should do that every day because the enemy comes before God, the accuser comes twice a day. We should plead the blood twice a day over everything in our life for protection. So in other words, when you got in the car, make sure you plead the blood. You say, I plead the blood in Jesus' name. And in that you were stating, I put the blood of Jesus on the doorpost of this car so the enemy cannot harm me. And there's some wonderful truths in that, but if not perceived right, it can also put you in danger. Let me explain. I plead the blood over my car. Then I drive my car and I'm safe because I have faith that I pleaded the blood. And therefore, because I pleaded the blood, therefore I am safe from being attacked by the enemy. I plead the blood over my children every day. I plead the blood over my bicycle, over my possessions. Enemy, you can't have them. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. I plead the blood. And you do it twice a day because the enemy, the accuser comes before the brethren twice a day. Well, when I got into discussions with some of these teachers, we had one service where a young man in a pastor's child broke their arm doing something. And I remember the teacher, a famous teacher, pulled that pastor on stage and interviewed him, teaching about the power of pleading the blood. And said, you know, I raised my kids and the word says that we can believe for no broken bone. And he looked at this young pastor. He wasn't a senior pastor, just an associate pastor whose child had just broken their arm earlier that day. And this world famous preacher said in front of everyone, now, I raised all my kids and none of them broke their arm. None of them had a broken bone, according to the word. But I plead the blood twice a day over my children. And that famous preacher, she looked over at this young pastor, said, I want to ask you a question. Do you plead the blood? Did you plead the blood over your child this morning? The young preacher said, I'm sorry, I don't believe I did. See, church, world famous preacher said, see, church, I want you to realize he didn't plead the blood. His child was not protected. The enemy could come and do what he wanted. And his child broke his arm because he did not plead the blood. You need to plead the blood faithfully twice a day. Well, fear gripped me, all of us. All of a sudden, we were pleading the blood over everything. I plead the blood. But what happens if you sleep in? This is the thought process the Holy Spirit began to help remove that sand out of my life, that sand of false doctrine out of my doctrine. Was what happens if I sleep in? And I run off to work because I'm late and I don't have time. I forget to plead the blood over my children, over their bicycles, over their toys, over my finances, over my car, over every ride, over everything. Am I subject to the enemy coming and freely just destroying them? And see, this type of legalism is hidden. It's not the blood of Jesus. Is not like a car alarm where you turn it on and turn it off. Blood on, beep, beep. Blood off, beep, beep. It's not like that. The blood of Jesus is the price that Jesus paid for you to be free of every attack of the enemy. And yes, we want to have faith in that. And yes, I think it's healthy to speak it. Lord, I thank you that the blood of Jesus has purchased for me the right as a child of God to stand above every attack of the enemy. The enemy can't just come and take my life. The enemy will not do it. And I thank you that the blood of Jesus provided that for me. See, that's healthy. What's not healthy is to think I have to speak the blood for it to work. I have to speak the blood for it to happen. Because if you believe, here's this verse here we read out of Galatians. Yet the law is not of faith, but the man who does them shall live by them. If you believe that the only reason the devil can't kill you in a car crash is because you pleaded the blood that morning when you started the car, before you drove off, then you better plead the blood every time you get in the car, because that's where your faith is at. Your faith is in you speaking the blood, not in what the blood had already purchased for you. I hope I'm making sense. It's a little thing, but it's a big thing. That legalism sneaks into our faith, into our works, into our walk with God, and can devalue the power of God that He has for you as a child of God. The blood of Jesus bought your salvation. It bought victory over the devil. That was the price that Jesus paid to make you a child of God, as a child of God. Jesus didn't walk around in His 33 years and a half years pleading the blood. I plead the blood. I plead the blood's going to happen. No, He walked because He was the Son of God. You are a child of God. You have that same righteousness in you right now as your new nature. And yes, it does require faith, but faith in what the blood gave us, not in my ability to speak it. It doesn't turn off at midnight and have to be renewed every day. It's healthy to speak the blood. Lord, I thank You that Your blood purchased for me the right to be free and safe. That's okay. But to plead it, Lord, I plead the blood, and because I spoke it, now it's going to happen. But it shuts off in 12 hours. I'll have to do it again. If that's the law you're living under, you're going to live by that law. You better plead the blood over everything. You better not forget your child. Better not forget anything. It's a little thing that can really, eventually, Paul's concern, can take away their salvation. It's the same way when we pray over food. You know, us church folks, we, you know, you're about to eat some food and someone says, whoa, 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 you know, who cooked the food? Well, so-and-so did. Well, do we pray over the food? Because if not, we may die of poison, you know. So there's, you know, if you don't pray over your food, then you might die of bad food, bad cooking. It's a joke, but some people believe it, that my food is only sanctified, it's only purified when I pray over it, give thanksgiving over it. And that verse of giving thanksgiving for your food is more about, it's okay for you. If you're worried about eating pork and things the Old Testament said not to eat, it's sanctified. Just thank God for it, and it's sanctified. It doesn't matter where it came from. It doesn't matter if it was meat offered to idols or pork. Just sanctify it by saying, Lord, thank You for this food. That's what that means. But many, many Christians, jokingly but half-jokingly, say, well, we got to pray. We better pray, or it might be poisonous. But they don't even believe that. Because you go to a Mexican restaurant, and everyone's eating chips and salsa before you pray for the main meal. You know, you sneak appetizers in and before you pray for the main meal. Well, what about the verse that says no poison thing shall harm you? Can you believe that, or do you have to pray for that first? See, those verses aren't activated by your words. Your faith is in what Jesus had done for you. So we do thank God for our meals, and we thank Him that we're healthy. But it's not that words that did it, it's what Jesus paid for. It's faith in what Jesus had done. So if I forget to pray for my appetizer, I still have faith that I'm not going to be poisoned, because the word says no poison thing shall harm me. I have faith in what Jesus had purchased for me, not in my words to activate it. We are not to be legalistic in trying to earn anything from God. We are to receive by faith what He has done for us. Yet the law is not of faith, but the man who does them shall live by them. That's a very powerful statement. Christ had redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us. It is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on the tree, that the blessings of Abraham might come upon the Gentiles in Christ Jesus, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. I want to pause there. We'll continue this in the next message on walking in righteousness, because we are righteous. What makes you righteous is not what you've earned. It's not what you do. What makes you righteous is that you have the nature of Christ in you. Do you have that nature in you? Are you born again? Then you're a child of God. You are as righteous as Jesus is. You are righteous because you're birthed into and by that righteousness. That new nature in you, the nickname is righteousness. And it oozes righteousness in your inner man. It's who you are. You may have an outward man that's carnal, but your inner man is made in righteousness and holiness. You have a right to believe God for all your, for your provision, for your healing, for your salvation, salvation of your loved ones, for deliverance from sin, from overcoming emotional struggles, based on what Jesus did for you and who He made you at your birth, at your rebirth. That's why you're righteous. That's the only reason you're righteous. You don't need another reason. If you add another reason, you are putting yourself under law and you're going to live by that law. If you think the only reason God's going to help you with your provision to feed your family, to feed you, is that you do this and do that, then you better do this and do that. And don't forget, because your faith is in your performance, not in what Jesus has already done for you. Jesus became sin so you can become righteous. You're a child of God. I look forward to continuing on this message. I love you. Thank you for spending time with me. I'll see you again soon. God bless.